This is Kurt Heisinger, accounting professor at Sierra College and author of Managerial Accounting. This video extends our discussion of activity-based costing. It's the part two video related to activity-based costing. And here we're going to discuss not only how the product cost information can be used when compared to other approaches to allocating overhead, but also it gets into the advantages and disadvantages of using activity-based costing and what the entries look like in an activity-based costing system. At the very end of the part one video, we established what the product cost would be, which you see down here toward the bottom, what the product cost would be for each of our products, the basic sailboat and the deluxe sailboat, using activity-based costing. And so that's what I've outlined here. It's really this section right here. Now with this slide, the extension of this discussion, we're going to take a look at what the how this compares to the plant-wide costing approach and what the profit looks like for each of these approaches. Let me set up this comparison a little bit further. Let's assume that our company, Sailright, which produces two sailboats that you see here, the basic and the deluxe, used to use the plant-wide costing approach. That's this here. And as a result, we were allocating overhead based on direct labor hours in one rate plant-wide based on direct labor hours. The result of that allocation is shown here for overhead, that overhead line item. And that was what we came up with as our overhead cost per unit for each of those products that we produce. You'll notice, too, that the direct materials and direct labor costs are above the overhead cost and are the same for both examples. If you go down to the bottom part, you'll see it there as well. Going back to the plant-wide costing approach, you'll see that our total product cost per unit for the basic boat was $2,880, and for the deluxe sailboat is $3,650. We also now have the sales price in here. That's this line item right here. And the sales price for the basic sailboat is $3,200, and the sales price for the deluxe sailboat is $4,500 per unit. As a result, our profit, according to our records back using this plant-wide costing approach, the resulting profit was $320 for the basic sailboat and $850 per unit for the deluxe sailboat. To continue to build this example, let's assume that management, based on our plant-wide costing information, decided to push the sales of the deluxe sailboat because the profits of the deluxe sailboat at $850 per unit are clearly higher than the profit for the basic sailboat of $320 per unit. The problem was, as the company continued then to push the sales of deluxe sailboats, perhaps offering higher commissions to our salespeople if they sell that deluxe boat, as we pushed that and increased our sales of the deluxe sailboat, our overall company profits went down. So something strange happened, right? If we increase the sales of our deluxe sailboat, it has the highest profit per unit, but our overall profit goes down. Something is going on here. And management then came to us, we're the managerial accountants, and asked us to reevaluate what our product costs are. We know the sales prices are accurate, but we aren't entirely sure about the product costs, particularly overhead, because overhead is that one product cost that is not easily traced to our individual products. After going through the activity-based costing process, as was shown in the part one video related to activity-based costing, we identified our overhead costs and established our overhead costs at $1,004 for the basic sailboat per unit and $2,980 for the deluxe sailboat per unit. And you'll see as a result then that our product costs per unit were significantly different than what we saw with the plant-wide approach, and that then, when subtracted from the sales price, gave us an entirely different profit amount per unit. So for the basic sailboat, our profits actually were higher than we initially thought. We initially thought our profits were $320 per unit, but after activity-based costing, it looks like those profits are $596 per unit. And our deluxe sailboat, instead of being $850 per unit in profit, we actually have a $530 loss for each unit we sell. So now this starts to explain why our overall company profits went down when we were pushing the sales of the deluxe sailboat. This leads right into our next slide, which outlines the advantages of using activity-based costing. First of all, activity-based costing, if done correctly, tends to provide more accurate cost information. And with more accurate cost information, hopefully we will see improved decisions being made by management. So it leads to better decisions. Now, I say hopefully. That's not always the case. It's really up to the managers to make those better decisions. But if they do use the information correctly, it should lead to at least more informed decisions. Secondly, looking at the second bullet point here, secondly, if we use activity-based costing, it increases our knowledge of the production activities that are involved in producing our products. Perhaps we didn't know about all these different activities, or at least how costly these activities were. So using activity-based costing provides us with that information, and with that information, hopefully we'll see some improvements in the process, in the production process, and as a result, reduce costs. What are some of the disadvantages of using activity-based costing? Obviously, not all companies use this approach to allocating overhead to products. Well, first of all, the activity-based costing systems tend to be costly. We have to have accounting personnel who know what they're doing, who have that expertise, and that's costly to hire those folks. The second consideration when implementing an activity-based costing system is understanding that unitizing fixed costs can be misleading. So we have to be careful about that. What that means is, once we establish a cost per unit at a certain level of production, if there are fixed costs in there, that cost per unit is only good at that level of production. If we start to change our level of production, then our cost per unit changes. That's the classic definition of a fixed cost. It stays the same in total, but as we change the level of activity, then the per unit amount of that fixed cost changes. And that's explained further in a separate video having to do with cost behavior identification. So we have to be careful about unitizing fixed costs and providing perhaps misleading information. We have to make sure that whoever's using that information understands that fixed costs are being unitized. The third potential disadvantage of using activity-based costing is that the benefits may not outweigh the costs. It may be that we put a lot of work into an activity-based costing system and a lot of resources, meaning money, and it turns out that the information that we get from that analysis and from that system doesn't really help us. The benefits from that information really doesn't help us in a way that outweighs the costs that we incur to obtain that information. When we talked about on the first slide the differences between using the plant-wide approach and the activity-based costing approach with these two sailboats and the fact that we had vastly different results, that doesn't always happen. It could be that we implement activity-based costing after having used the plant-wide approach and find that we don't have vastly different information. So the benefits may not outweigh the costs. How are overhead costs recorded when using activity-based costing? Well, first of all, it's important to understand that the flow of costs for a job costing system, it's the same whether we're using a plant-wide approach for allocating overhead, a departmental approach for allocating overhead, or activity-based costing for allocating overhead. It's really the same approach. The costs flow through all the same accounts, and so you might want to take a look at the job costing videos that have been posted, because that's where it's explained in detail how these costs flow through the accounts. The second bullet point here, the cost flows are the same, as I mentioned, but now we're using several different rates with activity-based costing instead of just one rate using the plant-wide approach for the entire plant, or a couple or a few rates related to each department within our production facility if we're using the departmental allocation approach. So we're just going to use several rates instead of one or two or three, and we have a rate for each activity when we're using activity-based costing. And then with this last bullet point, it's just sort of a quick review to show you the entry that we make when we do apply overhead costs to products, whatever system we're using. So once the overhead amount is calculated, again, whether it's using the plant-wide approach or the departmental approach or the activity-based costing approach, once we get the dollar amount, we are going to debit work in process inventory. It's an asset account. It's going up. And we're going to credit the manufacturing overhead account. So that entry is consistent regardless of the allocation method that we use.